I'm going to be speaking to somebody very special indeed. He's been a guest on this show before, live in the studio, of course, on the phone this time. And the reason that we're talking to him is that Joe Tresini has been extraordinary on social media. He has done something very powerful. He's also been very funny, and he's been very open and honest, and he joins me now. Joe, good afternoon.
Hello, Gabby. How are you?
Oh, I'm really well, thank you, my lovely. How nice to speak to you. What an extraordinary journey, and I've used that word, journey, yeah, I went there.
I appreciate that.
You've taken us on over the past couple of months.
Oh, thanks, Gabby. I appreciate it. Thank you.
I mean, just incredible. The thing that made me start watching you was that everybody I knew said, watch this clip. So I'm going to play a bit of this in, if I may, and then we're going to come back to you, okay?
Okay,
This is just...
Are you going to play out the radio? That's amazing.
Well, no, we're going to play this bit. You're here.
Yeah.
Put it on a coaster, immodest reptile, into Baba Ganoush, bag for life. Goujon, chimpanzee, pull it forwards. Ainsley Harriet, Ted Baker's real name is Ray. Really catch the lip on that. Wait! Pick up your ferrets.
Now, what's so wonderful is playing that without an introduction and
without
explaining.
Context.
Yeah, that to me is going to make everybody sit up and say, "What did I just hear?"
Right, I love the fact that we're talking about it on the actual radio. It's
real
amazing.
Radio, yes. Okay, so Joe, explain what we just heard.
Basically, when the lockdown happened, I saw loads of people really sincerely sort of trying to sort of help the world with dance on my Instagram and Twitter and helping people. And my girlfriend, Holly, is a dancer and I am not. And I thought, why not go upstairs and get a leotard and go and just try and have a laugh? And I just put a video on Twitter. Lots of people watched it, and the fact that still 3 months on, we're still making them and we're talking about it together now is utterly mental, and it's lovely.
Oh, Baba Ganoush.
Baba Ganoush, Baba Ganoush.
Did you
give me a loose munch.
Did you plan what you were going to do?
No, not at all. I don't know. I don't think anything through, Gabby, ever. So it's just, it's been a lovely thing to have on, really. It's, I'm mainly devastated for Lizzie, Holly's sister, whose leotard it is. My favourite comment that I've had out of all of them was just one on Instagram where Lizzie replied, Joe, my leotard. And it's still not been washed either, which isn't pleasant.
Oh, it's just, there's a wonderful clip. I'm urging everybody to go and watch these, and then we're going to talk about the extraordinarily powerful stuff you've also been doing. But there is this one clip where two guys on a little golf buggy, because you seem to live on a golf course, which is quite amazing.
These two guys
look at you and wonder what on earth is going on, you dancing in a leotard in your back garden.
I wish that I could pretend that was an accident, but I spent a week trying to get hold of somebody that could actually have a golf buggy that drove past and then back again. And we found two sort of friends of the family that lived up the road. And I've got an hour's worth of me laughing out loud because the golf buggy was coming in my peripheral vision. And I paid them by socially distancing, throwing a bottle of red wine and an Easter egg at them. So, yeah, that's how I've been filling my time anyway.
Oh, it's just wonderful. So what this is, the reason I wanted to get you on, though, is not only to congratulate you because you have brought us immense pleasure, but also, I know you and I know your daddy as well, and
yeah.
I had no idea about what you've been going through. So
yeah.
I know because you've said this online and you and I have now been messaging each other backwards and forwards that you are... Happy seems a very flippant word to use, but you are very open about talking about this. So
yeah.
You've been very open about mental health issues and
yeah.
More open than anyone I've ever seen. So what have you been going through that we didn't know?
Thanks, Gabby. That means a lot to me to say that. Thank you. I've got borderline personality disorder, which I describe as like a pound shop bipolar, because it does most of the same stuff, just some of it is a bit worse. And it sort of covers a really wide spectrum of basically all of the mental health problems crammed into one. And I mean, I was an alcoholic and a drug addict. I'm 8 years, coming up 8 years clean, and I'm 5 years sober. Thanks, Gabby. Thank you. But when I sort of fixed all of that, I realised that there was a much bigger problem that they were a symptom of. I think I waited quite a long time to talk about it publicly, because I think part of my problem is that I like to help other people, because it will stop me looking at myself. And I think if I'd have started talking about it publicly sooner, I would have been doing it for the wrong reasons. One of the biggest things that I have is that I am suicidal on a day-to-day basis. So I'm not, in saying that, I'm not a risk. I'm not going to kill myself, but I do think about it a lot. It's a symptom of the BPD.
Right, so can I, I'm going to stop you on a couple of things, if I may, Joe, just to get to try and understand it. So can we talk about BPD and exactly, I mean, you've made a video of what it's like. So it's, for people who don't understand this,
yeah,
what is it that you are hearing? What is it that you feel?
I have basically got the worst roommate in the world living in my head, and it's my voice, and he's there all the time, and he absolutely hates me, and unless presented with, he's entirely in control of my emotions. He's in control of my emotions and my thoughts. I can look at it quite factually, and I can sort of I work on evidence and he works on emotions, and I'm basically living with my own voice trying to destroy my life all of the time.
So that's the voice that tells you that you should end your life?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, constantly. But also because he's in control of like the emotions and things, he'll tell me to kill myself before giving me any of the other options for a situation. So if I'm waiting for a train and the train is cancelled, the BPD in me will offer me kill yourself as an option first. So the train's cancelled, and I'll go, kill yourself? I'll go, no. And I'll go, oh, okay, well, maybe get a cab. So as ridiculous as that sounds, that's kind of the everyday reality of it for me. But again, there is also a spectrum of that as well, because even though I've got a ground level of that, sort of constantly going on, there are some days where it's less of a suggestion and an instruction. I've been living with this for a very long time, and I have worked out a way that I can live with it, and I'm very lucky that I've got such an incredibly supportive girlfriend and family and a unit around me. Because I'm kind of used to it, but there are days that have to be exclusively me sitting and waiting to not be, but to, you know, because at some point I will stop thinking about killing myself. That's the key, is that at some, I've been suicidal for 8 years and I'm not dead. So I am, even though I talk about killing myself quite bluntly, I see the hope is the fact that I haven't killed myself and I'm not going to kill myself. But I have done some bad things in my life, Gabby. I've done some awful things. I've done lots of things to be ashamed of. But I'm not ashamed of the fact that I have these thoughts put into my head by something that I don't control. And I have a choice. And the choice that I've got is that I either listen to that voice and die with the awful things that I've done in my past now, or find a way of living with it. And I've found a way of living with it. It's exhausting, but you know, I'm here, and a massive part of me being able to be okay and living with it is talking about it. And I am fortunate that I get to talk about it in public. I was never interested in sharing my story. That was never a thing for me. It was never that I didn't start out, and I still don't do it to help people as such. I do it to help me. The more people I tell that I've got this thing inside of me saying, kill yourself, and all of the other awful things it tells me about myself, the more people I tell, the safer I feel in any given room. So I can feel safer going out because there's a possibility that someone there might know that I'm okay. And the more I talk about it, the more relaxed I am about saying these sort of out of the box things. In saying that, it's still utterly terrifying, Gabby. It's still just being on the phone to you now is still, even though I've been, you know, what I think 18 months I've been talking about it publicly, it's still a scary thing to say out loud, you know, hearing me say it, because again, the part of my brain that is telling me to do that doesn't want me to talk about it. It's only got power over me if it's got me on my own. So me telling you that he thinks about killing myself means that I can't kill myself. That's one of the most devastating things about suicide for me, having, you know, lost friends to it, having climbed onto the wrong side of the bridge myself at one point in my life. It is still... sorry.
No, listen, Joe, this is incredible. You are an incredible human being because you were sharing this and you're being incredibly honest. I'm overwhelmed hearing you speak. I find it incredibly moving. I think what we might do is, my darling, let's go to some music. I'm going to come straight back to you. So please don't go anywhere.
I'm here. And I'm also all right, by the way, just in case anybody's concerned.
I know you are.
Fine.
I absolutely know you are. You really are all right.